where it began. I can't begin to know who to believe you'd come along. Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
We're going to have a look together today at an incredibly famous painting by an incredibly famous artist. It's also absolutely enormous. It isn't in London, I'm afraid, so even after lockdown you would have to travel to go and see it. You would need to go to Spain, and specifically to Madrid, to the Reina Sofia Art Gallery, where this painting hangs permanently on a very large wall. It is Picasso's Guernica from 1937. Now, Guernica was the name of a small Basque hill town, which wasn't very famous at all until it was bombed on April the 26th, 1937, in support of General Franco's forces during the Spanish Civil War. Most of the inhabitants of the town were civilians, and a lot of people were killed as a result of the attack. Now, this painting is a painting which depicts absolute chaos, carnage, despair, distress, people weeping, people screaming, hands flung up over heads in agony and despair. There's a mother over to the right-hand side there, cradling her dead or dying child in her arms. There's a figure lying on the floor with his arms outstretched. There are horses and bulls, all looking absolutely terrified. And the image of terror seems to be this flash in the middle of the picture. Now, when Picasso heard about the events in Guernica, he wasn't in Spain. He was a Spaniard, but he was living in Paris. And he was in the middle of working on a commission for a painting that could be hung in the Spanish pavilion of that year's Universal Exhibition, so big exhibitions like we would call it the Great Exhibition. 1851, the Crystal Palace, was the first of its type. And there was due to be an exhibition in Paris in 1937, which Picasso was preparing a picture for. And when he heard news of the bombing of Guernica, he decided to change his subject from some paintings of the artist's studio to a painting of those events, inspired by those events. Now, you'll notice that it's in black and white, and that is because Picasso's way of finding out about the happenings in Guernica was via the newspaper. News reports reached him, and he saw that news in black and white in photographs. He didn't see it firsthand, so it's painted at one remove from everything that's going on. And yet at the same time, it seems so engrossed in those events, so encircled by them, so affected by them, and so affected by the news of his compatriots was Picasso, that he completely changed his plans for that exhibition's commission, and he spent 3 months pulling together this incredible painting. So it was painted between April 1937 and June 1937, and there are photographs of it in various states. Picasso changed it quite a bit as he went along. And this is the final version of that picture. Now, there are all sorts of things going on. We've talked about the images of anguish and distress, the images of not only people, but also animals. But actually, there's a lot of meaning behind some of this as well. And I wonder if it might be worth us starting with that bomb in the middle of the picture. Now, I say bomb, we've referred to it as a flash of light. And in some ways, we seem to be in a domestic space. So perhaps we might think of it as a light bulb. But there's a little bit of wordplay going on here as well, because in Spanish, the word for light bulb is bombilla, and the word for bomb is bomba. So it is both a light bulb and a bomb. And there's nothing worse, is there, than thinking about your domestic space being disrupted and suddenly becoming dangerous and lethal and catastrophic and chaotic. There's a hand reaching through that window there. The difference between inside and outside space has been completely collapsed, and one is being invaded by the other. There's a hand holding out a flame. Perhaps this is a candle that's trying to shed light on the situation. Perhaps the news reports that Picasso was reading were trying somehow to shed light on the events that had taken place and all those people who had died. Bulls and horses for Picasso weren't just bulls and horses, they weren't just local animals. Neither were they even animals that we might think of in a nice nativity scene, although with the woman and child there and the bull leaning over her shoulder, you might be forgiven for thinking about a nativity image. but actually for Picasso as a Spaniard, bulls and horses were animals that were affected by the traditional Spanish bullfight. And if you went to a bullfight, there would be a huge amount of bloodshed, and it wouldn't just be the bull who was killed ultimately if the bullfighters won, but also horses would be likely to be killed during that bullfight as well. So quite a barbaric sport, and one that Picasso was used to, but therefore those bulls and horses become images of sort of sacrifice, almost in the name of sport. This is a cruel sport, it's a cruel event that has taken place in Guernica, and it's the innocent parties that have been killed or damaged or destroyed or affected by those events. We've already pointed out the image of the mother and child, which reminds us of what we might think of as a Madonna and child type image, the Mary figure holding the baby Jesus, only in this instance she's holding a dead baby. That might draw us down the composition a little bit to thinking about another figure lying there with his arms outstretched. Another situation in which we often see paintings of Mary cradling a dead body, not a baby usually, but the dead figure of Christ who has died on the cross, is sort of being referenced there in two parts. We've got Mary and the baby, which is also just a civilian inhabitant of Guernica holding her child. Perhaps she's being raised to the status of that very famous mother and child. But also we have a reference there to the dying Christ with his arms outstretched lying at the base of the composition in that cross shape, looking like a sort of martyr to a cause. If you look closely at the composition, you'll see not only that this is a domestic space, which is terrifying enough, but also that there are sections of it which, if you haven't thought too carefully about the scale of this, you might be forgiven for thinking were actually made of newsprint. So the black and white colour scheme reflects the newspaper as a siphon of this information to Picasso. But also there are little stubs of black on the surface of some of those sections, in the middle in particular. You might think those were newsprint until suddenly you realise that actually this is such large scale, they couldn't possibly be. The writing would have to be enormous for that to be the case. And then down to the middle of those sections that look a bit like newsprint, there is this hole, there's a sort of scar almost in the middle of the composition. And this is one of the things that interests me about this picture most, because we have something that looks like words, and yet actually they're not words. And because they're not specific words, they're not tied down to a specific language. And so suddenly this picture is able to be not just about the bombing of Guernica in Spain with words in Spanish, but they become universal words. They're not in any particular language, and therefore they refer to the impossibility of speaking about the levels of grief and pain and agony that we see in this composition. There are some things that you just can't put into words, and that seems to be the implication of those stubby little bits of almost text that Picasso includes here. Picasso had used newsprint an awful lot in his compositions in earlier times. And in putting that hole down the middle there, he's also referencing back to his collages, perhaps of 1912, 13, 14, where sometimes he would leave a little bit of the composition blank without newsprint over the surface. But here, because of all the violence that's going on, and because perhaps of another little shape that scar seems to echo just to the right-hand side, it seems rather a lot like a spear wound. And perhaps it might even remind us of the spear wound in the side of the dying Christ on the cross. A lot of the limbs have been dismembered in this composition. Now, you might say that's purely the result of Picasso being a cubist painter. He was always dismembering limbs in order to get around the figure and analyse how figures were put together. But here, I think there's more of a sinister quality to it than that. If you look at the outstretched arm of the figure lying on the ground, it almost looks like a lump of meat, perhaps some Spanish ham that you might see in the window of a tapas bar. A figure, a person, a human being, reduced to limbs, lumps of flesh, things that we don't want to look at, we don't want to think about, and the impact of which is perhaps slightly reduced for us because of the loss of colour. I wonder if we were to insert some red into this, how much worse it would feel, or whether it almost seems worse because of the black and white qualities of that picture. Now, what in the world has all this got to do with our understanding of God, you might be wondering. I've hinted at the way in which Picasso is using some religious imagery there, figures that remind us of Madonna and Child type compositions, or figures that might remind us of the crucified Christ, images of animals that perhaps we're used to seeing in nativity scenes. But on top of that, I think we can agree that this is an image of absolute chaos. It's a universal image. It doesn't refer to one specific moment at one specific time. And therefore, perhaps it can even speak to us in the current situation. We're not in a war, although the times have been likened to that at times. But we are in a situation that feels somehow out of control. We're in a situation that we don't understand. In the same way as innocent cattle and humans were killed in that town of Guernica, we're seeing innocent lives cut short around us because there's something happening that we can't control. And sometimes we're saddened by that. Sometimes we are moved to tears. There are people around us who are grieving. I don't know if you know anyone who has been personally affected by this. Perhaps if you don't, you feel almost at one remove, and you feel as though via the media, via the reports that we're receiving through the newspaper, through the television, we're almost receiving those things secondhand and grieving with the people that we hear about. Perhaps you are experiencing that grief firsthand, in which case the anguish on the faces of some of these figures will probably ring incredibly true for you. So we're in a time where people are experiencing despair, a loss of understanding, a questioning, perhaps, of what God is doing.
Now, in addition to
that image of the mother and child that we've already noticed that reminds us of Mary and Jesus, and the figure on the ground that almost looks like a crucified Christ, if you just look up from that, in between the bull and the horse, you'll see one more image that perhaps reminds us of something biblical. And that is the image of a dove. Now, that dove is looking up, and its beak is open as if it's crying out in despair or agony or screaming in exactly the same way as the two women who flank this canvas. Now, for us, the dove tends to be an image of that third person of the Trinity, doesn't it? The Holy Spirit. And in this image, we find that the Holy Spirit, if that's what it refers to, is even crying out with the other figures of the composition. So once again, we have an image of a God who is close to his people. And I'm reminded of those words from Hebrews. So this is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14. Therefore, we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, and yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. This is not a God who is distant from his people. This is not a God who requires a newspaper report to understand how we are feeling. This is a God who knows directly from his own experience, going through the heavens, going through earth, going through hell for us, exactly what anguish and despair feels like. He even experienced his Father God turning his back on him as he took on the sin of the world. And because of that, he can identify with us. He's not a distant figure. He is a God who enters in to the images of our suffering in the way that he seems to enter into this canvas to be part of that picture of universal suffering that Picasso depicts. And amidst all of this chaos, where is God? He is there. He is the unshakable presence. And Hebrews chapter 12 reminds us of that. We are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Our God is not the bomb that will kill the innocent people. Our God is a God that will wipe out all the things that need to be shaken to leave us with a kingdom that cannot be shaken. He is the unshakable certainty amidst the chaos and doubt that we might be experiencing at the moment. Where is God in our chaos? He's right there with us. He understands it, and he is not shakable in the face of it. Amen.
So many people.
plans we made.